Hello friends, welcome to Achieve IAS. How are you? I hope you are doing well. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are covering the syllabus of UPSC Civil Services, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So currently we have 10 series that focus on your prelims and one series that focus on your mains. So in these prelim series, what we do, we daily pick up two topics and we discuss daily 10 to 15 questions of each topic, and then in this manner we daily cover 20 to 30 questions of two topics. And in this manner, we have demarcated 10 topics and we will cover them in a cyclic manner. For example, today we will cover first two topics, and tomorrow we will cover next two topics, and in this way the cycle will go on, and this series will continue till 31st May. So why the date chosen has been 31st May? Because on 2nd June is your prelims of UPSC CSE 2019. So friends, let's start our discussion without wasting much time. So this lecture is about geography. So we are covering the 10th lecture of geography. Already we have covered 9 lectures. So let's see what is the first question. So the first question is, in India, alluvial soils can be found in 1. Eastern coastal plains, 2. Western India, 3. Southern India. So we have to tell in which of these parts of India the alluvial soils can be found. We have to choose the correct answer. So let me tell you friends that the correct answer is D, that is 1, 2 and 3. So these alluvial soils, they are quite vast in their expanse over India. So they are found in the Indo-Gangetic plains and also in Western India, in this region of Gujarat and in Southern India also. So this is, the correct answer is D. So the explanation is here given before you. Justification is, the entire northern plains are made of alluvial soils, and also these soils extend in Rajasthan and Gujarat through a narrow corridor, and also these can be found in eastern coastal plains and particularly in the deltas of Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna and Kaveri. So all are correct. So 2nd is also correct, and 1 and 3 is also correct. So D option is correct. So let's move on to the second question. The second question is, the Mongoloid Champin tribe can be found in which of the following protected areas in India? A. Nokrek Biosphere Reserve, B. Rastamalai Biosphere Reserve, C. Nilgiri Biosphere, D. None of the above. So let me tell you friends that the answer is D, none of the above. And this Mongoloid Champin tribe is actually found in the Great Nicobar region. So and it is not mentioned here. So D would be the answer, none of the above. So here is the explanation. So it is precariously poised on brink of extinction. So as the other four hunter-gatherer tribes of the Andaman and Nicobar islands. So they are found in Great Nicobar Reserve. The name of the protected area where they are found is Great Nicobar Reserve. And they are classified as primitive tribal group, and they are living with four other tribes in this area. So they are not of Negrito but of Mongoloid stock. So they look similar to the people of Myanmar and Indonesia. So they are found in Great Nicobar Great Nicobar region and Great Nicobar Reserve. So they were until 1960s they were undisturbed, but after that there was a major influx, and this disturbed the Champin populations. So this is about your second question. So let's move on to the third question. Third question is, which of the following statements about Rager soils is incorrect? A. It has high porosity among all soil types. B. It is generally poor in phosphoric contents. C. They are suitable for growing cotton. D. It can be found in Deccan Trap and Malwa Plateau. So we have to tell which of the following statements is incorrect. So let me tell you friends that yes, Rager soil is good for growing cotton, and it is also known as black soil. And let me tell you that it has lower phosphoric content, but yes, it has high kind of potash contents and this lime and magnesium also. So but this soil has poor phosphoric contents. About this D, this is also correct because they are found in Deccan Trap as well as Malwa Plateau. But let me tell you friends that their porosity is not high. They lack the porosity. In fact, they trap water, they trap moisture in due to this property. So they are not highly porous. So the A statement is incorrect. So here is the explanation. So it is ideal for growing cotton and also known as black cotton soil. So they are extremely fine and clay, that is clay material, they are type of clay. So due to which they retain moisture. And in dry season, when the moisture kind of moisture moves out of these soils, deep cracks develop in them, due to which their aeration takes place, the aeration of the soil takes place. So in this manner, this soil is rich in nutrients like calcium carbonate, magnesium, potash, and lime, but phosphoric contents are poor in it. So it is believed that climate condition along with the parent rock are important factors for their formation. And the soil type is typical in Deccan tribe, basalt region spread over northwestern Deccan plateau, and it is made up of lava flows. So they cover the plateaus of Maharashtra, Saurashtra, Malwa, Madhya Pradesh, and Chhattisgarh. So they also extend in southeast direction along the Godavari and the Krishna valleys. So let's move on to the fourth question. Consider the following about the manganese nodules found in the oceans. So friends, you might have seen the manganese nodules that are found in oceans. So we have to consider the statements about it. First, they are generally found within shells floating at the sea surface along with phytoplankton. Second, they mainly contain manganese, cobalt, nickel, and copper. Third, crude oil is extracted from these nodules in the Indian Ocean. So we have to choose the correct statement from these given statements. So let me tell you, friends, they are not found floating at the sea surface. In fact, they are found at the bottom of the sea. So first is clearly incorrect, but yes, they mainly contain manganese, cobalt, nickel, and copper. And also let me tell you, friends, the third is incorrect. Crude oil is not extracted from them. So the answer is second only. So the A should be the answer. So here is the solution. So they are polymetallic nodules, also known as manganese nodules, and they are found on the sea bottom. And they are found by the concentric layers of iron and manganese hydroxides around a core. So it mainly consists of manganese, cobalt, nickel, and copper. So the core mainly contains the manganese, cobalt, nickel, and copper, and they are kind of covered by the layers of iron and manganese hydroxides. And also they do not contain crude oil. India has got the right to mine manganese nodules from the bed of the Indian Ocean, from that area which lies beyond the exclusive economic zone. But the fact main thing is that it will disturb the kind of the bottom ecology. Bottom deep sea ecosystem and could threaten the species surviving there, and also the due to the mining the waste material may get suspended, the suspended material may get and this could be eaten by those lives, those benthic creatures that feed on this sediment. So this sediment can then smother these filter feeders. So in this way they will get affected. So this it is not sustainable. So let's move on to the fifth question. Fifth question is, these are water channels that are found in precipitous mountain areas of Himachal Pradesh for carrying water from glaciers to villages in Spiti Valley. The statement refers to. So friends, here the water channel, particular water channels are created in precipitous mountain areas of Himachal Pradesh, and they carry water from glaciers to the villages for the irrigation purposes. So they are a kind of native technology used for tapping the water from the glaciers and then using this for irrigation purposes. So here it has been asked that what are these water channels are called. Zabo, Khatri, Nola, and D is Kuls. Let me tell you, friends, that the answer is Kuls. D is the answer. So this part of Himachal Pradesh had evolved this local system of canal irrigation called Kuls over 400 decades. So this is about your explanation. So let's move on to the sixth question. Sixth question is, the roaring 40s are A, strongly westerly winds found in the southern hemisphere, B, feeble easterly winds found in northern hemisphere, C, thunderstorms often found near the equator, D, equatorial countercurrents that move near the eastern coastal shores in lower latitude. So friends, we have to choose the statement that defines the roaring 40s. Let me tell you, friends, that the answer is A, strongly westerly winds found in southern hemisphere. So they are actually the roaring 40s. There are kind of furious 50s also after that. So solution is A, they are found between latitudes of 40 and 50 degrees. So that's why they are called roaring 40s. So they are strong west to east air currents. So they were westerly air currents, and they are caused by the combination of air being displaced from the equator towards the south pole and the earth's rotation, and there are few land masses to serve as wind breaks. And these roaring 40s were a major aid to ships sailing the Brewer route from Europe to the East Indies or Australia during the age of sail. So this is about your this statement. And let's move on to the seventh question. Because seventh question is, consider the following about Ken Betwa river linking interlinking project. First is, it will be first river project that will be located within a tiger reserve. B, it will irrigate the highly drought affected and drought prone region of Bundelkhand. So we have to choose the correct statement from these two statements. So let me tell you friends that both these statements are correct. Yes, it is a project that is river connecting project that links Ken with Betwa river, and this first river project that is located between a tiger reserve. So yes, it will help in indicating the highly drought affected regions of Bundelkhand. So the answer is both 1 and 2. So the solution is C. So actually, it will submerge 10% of the Panna Tiger Reserve, that is in Madhya Pradesh. So it is also fated as a model tiger conservation reserve. But due to the interlinking, 10% of the area would be submerged under this tiger of Panna Tiger Reserve will be submerged under this interlinking project. So this is about your first statement, and let me tell you, yes, it will supply irrigation to the dry regions of Bundelkhand and other districts of Madhya Pradesh like Chhatrapur, Raisen, Panna, Tikamgarh and Vidisha. So by assured irrigation supply, domestic and industrial water supply. But let me tell you friends that the people of local people will be affected due to this interlinking project, like nearly about 20,000 people in 38 villages. So let's move on to the next question. Eighth question, which of these tribes can be found in eastern Himalayan region? So here we have been asked that which of the following tribes is found in eastern Himalayan region. One, Rabhas, the second, Hajongs, three, Khamti, fourth, Chakmas. So we have to choose the correct answer. So let me tell you friends that all these tribes are found in the eastern Himalayas. So the solution is D, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So here is justification. Rabha is a scheduled tribe community of Assam, Meghalaya and West Bengal. And there is also this Hajong people. They are spread out across northeast India, West Bengal, Bangladesh, and they are predominantly rice farmers. And after that comes this Lohit district of Arunachal Pradesh. These Khamti tribes are found in this region. So next is Chakmas, who practice this Buddhism. They are also found in northeastern India. So these two tribes, that is Khamti tribe and this Chakma tribe, they practice Buddhism. So the answer is all of these tribes are found in eastern India. Let's move on to the next question. Ninth question is, consider the following about Brahma Kamal that is native to Himalayas and Uttarakhand. So friends, there is a plant called Brahma Kamal. So we have to choose that it is native to Himalayas and Uttarakhand. So we have to choose the statements about it which are correct. First, it blooms during monsoon season and perishes before the winter season. So let me tell you friends that yes, this is correct. It appears during monsoon season and perishes before the winter season. Yes, second statement is also correct, that it has medicinal properties. So both the statements are correct. So the answer would be C. So it is basically found in Uttarakhand region at an altitude of 3000 to 4800 meter. And according to the folklore of Hindu mythology, this Brahma Kamal was created by Lord Brahma to help Lord Shiva place the head of an elephant on the body of Lord Ganesha. So the flower dropped Amruta, the elixir of life, from its petals on the body. So it is state flower of Uttarakhand. So it is native to Uttarakhand, and also it helps in cuts and bruises as local medicine. So this Brahma Kamal is an herb in Tibetan medicine, and it is somewhat bitter in taste and it promotes heat. So now let's come to the 10th question. 10th question is, consider the following statements about the cyclone Titli. So friends, a few months back cyclone Titli came. We have to consider the statements about it. First is, the regional integrated multi-hazard early warning system for Africa and Asia has termed Titli as rarest cyclone. Second, it has caused considerable destruction in Odisha in October month. So we have to choose the correct answer. So let me tell you friends that both of these statements are correct, because rhymes this multi-hazard early warning system has defined it rarest of the rare cyclone. So the answer first is correct. Yeah, second is also correct. It has caused lot of destruction. So both 1 and 2 are correct. So basically there is no explanation for this. It is a simple fact that yes, it is rarest of rare, and also it has caused considerable destruction. So it is a simple statement. So let's move on to the 11th question. The 11th question is, Consider the following about statements about rhymes. So now regional integrated multi-hazard early warning system. So we have to consider certain statements about it. First, rhymes is an intergovernmental body registered under the United Nations. Second, it is being owned and managed by 45 collaborating countries in Asia Pacific and Africa region. Third, the program unit of the agency is located in Thailand. So we have to choose the correct statement. So which of these statements are correct? Let me tell you, friends, that all these statements are correct. Rhymes is an intergovernmental body that is registered under the United Nations and it is being managed by the 45 collaborating countries in Asia and Pacific and Africa region, and the program unit of the agency is located in Thailand. And yes, and let me tell you, friends, that India is currently chairing the RIMES. So it is a basically a kind of early warning framework, multi-hazard early warning framework that came into existence after the in the aftermath of 2004 Indian Ocean tsunami. So the answer is all are correct, so the solution will be D. So let's move on to the 12th question. The 12th question is, consider the following statements about El Nino. First, El Nino favors eastern Pacific hurricanes and tropical storms. Second, record and unusual rainfall in Peru, Chile and Ecuador are linked to this climate pattern. Third, El Nino reduces upwelling of cold water, decreasing the uplift of nutrients from the bottom of the ocean. So we have to choose the correct statement. So let me tell you, friends, that all of these statements are correct. Yes, El Nino is a kind of climatic phenomena. It doesn't happen normally. It is a kind of anomaly in weather phenomena, climate in anomaly in weather phenomena, kind of, we can say that. And this causes Eastern Pacific Ocean, this makes it in this condition it becomes hot, and this western parts of western Pacific becomes cold. So this is a kind of reversing of the order, and otherwise mostly the eastern part, that is the coastline, the coastline of Peru, Chile and Ecuador is usually cold because there is continuous upwelling of cold water there, and the Asian Ocean waters are hot. But in this El Nino condition the temperature reverses. So due to this this condition leads to hurricanes and tropical storms near the eastern Pacific region, that is Peru, Chile and Ecuador. And yes, there is a record and unusual rainfall, so it is basically again repetition, because obviously if there are hurricanes and tropical storms, so certainly there will be unusual and record rainfall. So third is also correct. It reduces the upwelling of cold water, and this decreasing the uplift of nutrients from the bottom of the ocean. So all the statements are correct, so the answer would be B. So here is in detail explanation. So it is a climatic cycle characterized by high air pressure in the western Pacific and lower pressure in the eastern. So this is basically about your El Nino. So there are major effects of it, so you have to read them. So please do ensure that you read them. And it is La Nina. Here it is La Nina. La Nina is basically nothing, but it is opposite of El Nino. So it is kind of extremely cold conditions in your eastern Pacific Ocean and extremely hot conditions in your western Pacific Ocean. So it will basically El Nino or La Nina episode last for 9 to 12 months. So it is not a kind of evergreen phenomena. So it is not like this that it will remain there for all of it becomes established there forever. So it is not for a forever kind of phenomena. So let's move on to the last question of today, the 13th question. So we have to consider certain statements about El Nino Southern Oscillation. First, it is nothing but a broader term for El Nino and La Nina. Second, it is periodic but irregular. So we have to choose the correct statement. Let me tell you, friends, that both the statements are correct, because this El Nino Southern Oscillation is nothing but it is actually a broader term which includes both El Nino and La Nina. So obviously kind of oscillation of temperature takes place. So that's why it is called El Nino Southern Oscillation. So El Nino and La Nina both comes under it. So it is a broader term for El Nino and La Nina. And yes, it is periodic, it comes every 2 to 7 years, but it is irregular. So it is not that the case that it will come surely after 3 years, regularly after 3 years. So after two to seven years it kind of emerges and shows its effects on the weather as well as climate and other living organisms also in the oceanic regions. So both of the statements are correct. So here is learning. So basically, as I have told you, that it is basically nothing but it is El Nino Southern Oscillation and an irregular periodic variation of wind and sea surface temperature. So the warming phase of ENSO is called El Nino, while the cooling phase is called La Nina. So these are the questions of friends today. If you like the questions, please like our video, share it with your friends, and please subscribe to our channel. And also do not forget to press the bell icon, because then only you will get all the important notifications relating to UPSC CSE 2019. And friends, lastly, let me announce that those students who want to subscribe for the PDFs of these MCQs, they can contact us at this number and or this email ID. So this is our email ID, that is achieveies21@gmail.com, and the contact number is 8968426481. So you can contact at this number, given number, to get the PDFs of these MCQs. So let me tell you friends, that as we are putting in a lot of effort, so certainly these PDFs will be at a certain minimum cost. So that cost has been kept for the purpose of for our motivation purposes and for the purpose of sustainability of the channel. So if you wish to join for the PDFs, then you can contact us at this number. Because friends, why the PDFs are important, because at the end of the day you will not be able to see 20 to 30 minute long video, or for that matter you will not be able to read standard books or NCERTs, because at that time you will have to revise multiple topics, and it would be an utter wastage of time if you relied on the videos or for that matter on the standard books. So at that time you must have some kind of notes from which you can revise quickly as well as comprehensively. So this is only possible in case of PDFs. So these PDFs are designed in a way that they are focusing on your prelims part. So obviously they will be covering your important concepts as well as your the concepts that are important for the exam. So if you want to subscribe to these PDFs, so you can contact us at this number, that is 8968426481, and this email ID, that is achieveies21@gmail.com. So friends, this is all about today's video. Thank you, have a nice day.